1010 WOLB Baltimore and WERQ-FM HD3 Baltimore.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
We are back for the second hour of the Frank M. Conaway Sr. and Al Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Good morning, Baltimore and beyond. Thank you for joining us again this second hour. I would like to start off by thanking Joy Robinson from the Cash Campaign of Maryland for coming on during the first hour and sharing information with us about their free financial fitness fair for the whole family. This day is entitled Money Power Day, and it will take place this Saturday, March the 23rd, 2024, from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. at Poly Western High School campus located at 1400 West Cold Spring Lane in Baltimore, Maryland. So if you have any questions about your finances, if you want to attend, that will be the perfect day and the perfect opportunity for you to attend with your family or with your business partners to get more information on how to be financially fit. Once again, I'm Tehma Smith Wilson. I can be personally reached at 667-334-7242 for any of your real estate or estate plan services. And if you cannot get through in the phone lines and you want to text your question or your comment, you can text it to 667-334-7242.
You want to announce about the play? I tell you what, before you announce, tell you what I'm going to do. I didn't bring them with me, but if we could hook up somehow, I'll give them to you. You can offer 5 tickets on this hour. I have them. I just have to get them to you so you can get disperse.
Not a problem. We can work that out.
Yeah. And you put out there whatever you want to put out, how they get them. The first 5 to text or something?
Yes. Just text me. Once again, 667-334-7242. If you're interested, text me. I will follow up with you and get them out to you.
And this is on behalf of the Carlton Douglas Funeral Service. We are offering 5 free tickets. Me and the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show for those 5 that text Tehma. Go ahead, Tehma.
Which show?
Right. Let us know which show. We'll try to work.
5 o'clock.
Sorry. Let us know which show. Yeah. We'll try to work with you to make sure you get the show of your choosing. The date is Good Friday, March the 29th, 2024.
But the one I'm offering is 5 o'clock because I already purchased them.
Not a problem.
Okay. All right. You want to go ahead and talk about the show?
Yes, it's the homegoing service for a man named Jesus. It will take place this Good Friday, March the 29th, 2024. 2 showings, 1 at noon, 1 at 5 o'clock. Takes place at the Huber Community Life Center. The tickets are $25 if you don't win any. You can go online and purchase them. Go to www.battlestageplays.com. Thank you very much.
Our other co-host.
And, of course, I play the role of Matthew.
You ain't supposed to tell. He's supposed to come to the show to see who we are in the show.
All right.
Didn't you hear Rose telling you that?
Okay. All right.
And our other co-host.
This is Robert Dashiell again. My number is 410-547-8820. If you have a procurement issue with the local or state government, I'm happy to try to, or contract issue, I'm happy to try to help you. But I am in the show, so come and see.
That's right. And I am too. Come and see. Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number is call is 410-669-1738, 410-669-1738. And the viewing for Mr. Calvin Brown is today from 3 to 7 at the Maranatha Truth Center, located at 701 East 25th Street, with services tomorrow. The family time will be 10, and the funeral will begin at 11. Calvin is very well known of the Brown family from out of East Baltimore. Just one heck of a guy. I also want to, many of you may not know, but we lost this past Sunday, Grammy Award winning gospel artist Sandra Crouch, who was the twin sister to Andre Crouch. Two of the greatest gospel songwriters and performers of the modern gospel age. I was telling a story the other day about her brother Andre, how I met Sandra some years ago. The legendary icon, Aunt Pauline Wells Lewis, who was the gospel disc jockey here and promoter of gospel here in Baltimore, called me up. In her later years, she couldn't drive. So either her assistant Aurelia or sometime Moya or myself were taking to different places where she had to go. And she called me up and she said, "Carlton, you want to go see Andre Crouch?" I say, "Andre who? Who is that?" She said, "Oh, Andre Crouch is probably one of the leading gospel writers and artists of today. Many blacks don't know about him because he's on the white circuit. However, he is known through Church of God in Christ because he was born and raised in the Church of God in Christ." So I said, "Okay, let's go." So we went over to your alma mater, Bob, the old Murphy Auditorium in Morgan. And we heard Andre, and it was a different kind of gospel. And he was selling records like mad back then because he was on the white Christian circuit and Church of God in Christ circuit. And that's when I met his sister, Sandra. He had in his group at that time, he had Sandra and Tata Vega and Danny Bell, who's no longer with us. And later on, about several years later, he produced the album for Sandra, which became a Grammy Award-winning gospel album. And Sandra came back to Baltimore and performed at Bethel AME on Drill Avenue. And Aunt Pauline and I, again, went there. So truly, she will be missed. One of the great ones is gone. There's not too many of the legendary black gospel artists that are left now. I thought I would let you know because a lot of people didn't know about it. All right. Now, we are coming back to the phone lines in this order. Lee, I believe it's Mark. It's M-A-R-C, I believe. Paul, Haki, and Rashid. Yeah, Tehma.
I have a question from the text message before we go to the phone line, and this question is directed to you. They want to know, can a veteran have more than one wife buried in the VA cemetery?
Yes, he can. And let me tell you, and I've had a case like that. I had a case about, some years ago, in which the veteran died before the last wife. And when she passed, she was out of town. She was living with her daughter in New York. And the daughter called back to me and said, "Mr. Douglas, my mother's passed. We want you to handle it and want her to be buried with her husband." Well, when I called Garrison Forrest to make the plans, Garrison Forrest called me back and said, "Mr. Douglas, we're trying to find room for that wife." I said, what do you mean he's trying to find room for the wife? They said because he's got two other wives already buried here. He had been married three times.
Mm.
Two of the wives that he had
predeceased him. Mm.
And then when the third wife died, she was entitled to be married with her husband.
Right.
You sure they weren't marrying him for his benefits?
I don't know.
His burial benefits.
I don't know. But that was yes. That is definitely a yes, because I had a case exactly like that, and I'm sure he ain't the only one out there like that. But it was very, very peculiar that this guy had three wives buried with him, and they had to find room.
And when you say buried with him, just in the cemetery?
No,
adjacent.
Adjacent to him.
Oh.
See, that was the problem, because, mm-hmm. all right, the first wife was buried there first.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. They automatically had a space for him.
Right.
But then he got married again, mm-hmm. and that wife died. Well, they had to put her in that area.
Between.
For him.
Okay.
So, and now they got to save another area for him.
One on each side.
Right. Okay. He passes away.
Mm-hmm.
He's with the two wives.
Mm-hmm.
The third wife passed away after him and wants to be buried with him.
Mm-hmm.
So they had run into a problem, and they had to make a way to get her in there.
And they haven't started limiting it after that?
No. No, because they're entitled.
Okay. Yeah. Sounds good.
Yeah. Okay. Here's some things I want to throw out. They still have not decided how this juvenile justice bill is going to come out. Now, we don't have much more time. I think the legislature ends when, Bob?
About 3 weeks.
April?
April 8th, I think. I think it's the 8th.
Okay.
But about less than 3 weeks now.
Okay. So everybody's watching, trying to see how that's going to work out. They're also trying to figure out, are they going to be nickel and diming us on fees and other things so they can claim that they didn't raise taxes, but they had to go up on licenses and fees to make up that money that they don't have and they want to spend. Mr. Trump has until Monday to find actually $500 million. Or Letitia James, the attorney general for New York, says she's going to go in and take whatever he got from the bank accounts to his buildings to take care of that debt that's owed New York through the court system. Also, he's giving out this facade that if you donate to the RNC, all the money is going toward his campaign. Well, that ain't necessarily true. Because when you give that money to it, he's skimming off the top to help pay his legal bills. And that's making a problem for the RNC because they don't have nearly the money that Mr. Biden has to run for the presidency. And it seems that the big money donors that Trump had before are not giving up the money like they did before to help him out. Now, my question is, your son, now y'all was going after Hunter Biden for whatever that you haven't come up with any evidence of yet. But Hunter Biden got $2 billion, not million. It's a billion with a B from Saudi Arabia. You can't, he can't borrow $500 million.
You mean Jared Kushner?
Jared Kushner, yeah, I'm sorry. His son-in-law.
Yeah.
Got $2 billion from Saudi Arabia. He can't ask Jared for $500 million to help him out? What's going on here? Elon Musk, his buddy, that said he ain't giving him nothing, at least not for that. You know, he may help him out some other way. But what's going on here? Mr. Trump claims he was worth $10 billion. If you're worth $10 billion, it ought not be a problem for you to $500 million to bail you out of this situation. something's going on.
Well, you know, he couldn't borrow money from U.S. banks before, which is why through Jared Kushner's relationship with the lady in Israel who's no longer there, who's a special vice president for the Deutsche Bank, the special assets division. But that's why he had to go to the Deutsche Bank to get money. So, and the problem with raising money or collateralizing whatever assets he has now to raise money from U.S. banks is that you would leave the bank in the rather ironic position of loaning money to secure an appeal on a judgment that was made for fraud against the banks.
Right, because he was inflating his assets.
So you got this huge judgment for bank fraud, and I think most banks would be very leery of making a loan to secure an appeal on a judgment that was given because of fraud committed against themselves.
And they claimed 30 bond companies turned him down.
Yeah, except, well, that not turned him down, but, they've got a monitor, the retired federal judge who's supposed to be monitoring his assets for the next 3 years. But supposedly there was an offer of a bond up to $91 million or something. But
they got that one.
Yeah, but from Clearway, I forget the name of the bonding company.
Chubb.
Yeah. But that's the largest. No other surety company or bank, so far as I know, has stepped up. Now, and I read some. Elon Musk says that they had breakfast or coffee together a few days,
last week.
And Trump didn't ask him for the money.
Yeah.
I don't think he wants to put the money up. I think he's still angling to be able to prosecute the appeal without having to post a bond or cash, quite frankly. And that's because that's what anybody would be doing. You try to avoid it if at all possible.
And what situations do they make you post a bond in order to have an appeal? Because I know when people go to jail for death row or whatever, I mean, they can post two or three appeals and then cost them money.
That's criminal. This is civil.
Well, the bond is to avoid enforcement of the judgment while the appeal is pending. It's not really a condition of the appeal. The appeal is filed. He's already filed the appeal. What the problem is, what happens to the judgment while the appeal is pending?
Right.
The purpose of the bond is to keep the judgment holder from executing against your assets until the appeal is heard.
And I'm just thinking that the judgment should be held up until after the appeal is finalized.
No, that's
like,
not.
Suppose they do issue a judgment, you do give them the money, and then you go to the appeal, you win the appeal, do they give the money back to you?
Yeah. Because you won the appeal.
But I'm just saying, in what time frame or what have you? Why transfer money and then you have appeal and then they have to transfer it right back? Do they have to do it within 30 days?
Remember now, the judgment results from a litigation where a party has established that you did something wrong to them and that you owe them money.
Right.
If you could stay enforcement of collection on that debt, which is a fixed debt at that point, if you could stay collection of that debt simply by filing an appeal, everybody would file an appeal all the time, and you would just pass it on. And sooner or later, something could happen to so that the person who was owed the money never, in fact, collected on a debt which you had been adjudged to be liable for. So the law in most jurisdictions is that while you can file the appeal, if you want to stay enforcement of the judgment, you have to post a bond to protect the interest of the party who's already proven that they're entitled to the money.
Okay,
if that's how it works and I give them judgment, I'll win my appeal, right? They give the money back to me. Do I get that back with interest?
If I do get it back with interest,
I mean, it's only fair to get it back with interest, but then the company who filed the original suit, now they out of money.
If the judgment is reversed after the judgment has been paid, then the party who collected the money would have to repay it. Now, if the creditor.
Because I mean, that only makes sense.
I don't know whether it's interest or not. I've never had a situation where a judgment holder was paid and the case was appealed and reversed on appeal, which is unlikely in the first instance, but was reversed on appeal, and the judgment holder was in a position where they had to consider how and when and under what circumstances they would repay the money. I've actually never seen that. I'm sure it's happened, okay, but I've never experienced it.
All right, we're coming to the phones now. We're coming in this order. Lee, Mark, Haki, Rashid, and someone is on now, and I think somebody dropped off. You want to call back, fine. And Chuck. Okay. Let's start with Lee. You on air, Lee.
Good morning, family. How everybody doing on this Friday?
All right.
Hey, 3 points real quick, Carlton. First, Tehma, when do you drop it on YouTube? Because I missed it last week, and I've been searching. I can't find the one from last week.
Well, you haven't looked since 4 o'clock this morning because it's on air. Yeah, it depends on my schedule throughout the week. I try to put them up as soon as possible. But the one, part two is on there now. When we leave here, part two, one will go up.
Gotcha. Appreciate that. Yeah, because if I miss a show, I'll be trying to catch it on YouTube. Plus, I got a few other people that listen.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, appreciate you. So back to Elon Musk. Did y'all hear, I think it was last week, he shot his starship, his spaceship into space successfully this time. Did anybody hear about that?
Yeah, I heard about it.
Okay, yeah. What do you think about that, Carl?
When I think about it?
Yeah.
Well, I ain't no fan of Elon Musk, so I don't know if you might want to hear what I got to say about that, but I really am not. I think Elon Musk is a white supremacist with a irrational ego. I think the United States government ought to sever ties with him with this space thing. Because I think he's a dangerous man that also gets high off of substances that are unknown to us.
I think he got an agenda and a plan that he's trying to fulfill.
Yeah.
You know, and but anyhow, all right, so back to the why white people don't like black people. I'm going to make it real short. I think it's because black people got swagger, and I'll leave y'all with that. Have a great weekend.
Okay. I hear you. We got a line open, 410-481-1010. We're going to, I believe this is Mark. Is this Mark?
Yeah, M-A-R-K, Mark.
Okay.
Yes. But in the proper age, I think it's all on the individual as far as teaching your kids about black history. It's basically their comprehension of it. It's not to go out to seek revenge on white people as far as physical, burning them up, fighting them, but it's a way that you need to be the balance of your thinking and let you, even when you start working, interacting with other kids, with sports and all that. Because my granddaughter, we taught her when she started reading around 4 years old, real comprehending what she reading. So she wanted to be a lawyer, so she got to understand black history. And she got to understand what this country was built on. Like when I go in the store, I show her, say, how are people coming in these stores and throwing shoes all over the place and don't pick them back up? I remember, and I'm just 63, that I remember when going to the shoe store, they put the wooden thing on your feet, measure your feet, and then take the shoe box up to the counter. They measure your head, reach up on the shelf, get that hat. You didn't keep trying hats on and throwing them down. So it's history all over through the city, your own city of Baltimore. You can see where the history that we had to fight to make things better for these generations now, so we can't just let it go away. We got to let them know what you experience, your grandparents experience, and what you're going to experience. Because kids going to come home crying and they going to understand why they went out in the world and this happened and that happened. Because they only had the basic understanding of their history. So it's to balance them out when they go out in the world and challenge this thing. Now, you ain't turning the TV off every time you see, you know, not get on gay relationship, but they have straight up gay relationships right on TV. You ain't turning the channel and say, close your eyes and this and that. So the you got to watch with the TV, radio, and everything pushing on your kids and molding them to be a part of something. So why are you going to let them not be a part of understanding their own black history and the struggle that their grandparents, great-grandparents, and everybody went through to make life better for them at this present time.
Okay. Thank you, Ma.
And two, Carlton.
Uh-huh.
Brandon is the new mayor again. We got to go with Brandon. No, don't stagnate.
No, you go with Brandon. I ain't going with him. You go with him. Hakeem, Rashid, Ernest, and Chuck, and we got one line of them. 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. Brother Hakeem.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. How y'all doing?
Fine.
Good. Well, I wanted to just offer, so I'm actually heading to Annapolis. Many of you know I've been serving on the Maryland Black Caucus Foundation for the past 4 years. That's a 6-year term for me, and a parliamentarian there. It's crossover in Annapolis, but I'm certainly pushing for an expanded role for the foundation. But there were several political things that were going on. I want to tie it into what Sister Tehma was sharing earlier. But, there was two U.S. Senate forums this week, I would guess. The Baltimore City Democratic State Central Committee had a forum. Shout out to them for, bringing that together. And they are as well back to having their regular meetings in person. But then there was a forum, a U.S. Senate forum at New Psalmist, and that was pretty live. I want people to, look at that. And the Afro newspaper did a good job with covering that.
Brother Hakeem.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
We had a call about New Psalmist where the person said the only person that showed up was Angela. Now, who showed up at that other forum you talked about?
Unless they were saying, Angela showed up at that one too, unless they were saying that Trone didn't show up at both. Cause
they said Trone nor Hogan showed up.
No, Hogan did not.
So now, the first one you talked about, who showed up there?
Well, that was just a few. That was the Central Committee, so that was for a Democratic candidate. So Trone did not show up again.
Okay.
So right.
That's showing you how much he think about you.
Yeah, well, then let me tell you. No, yeah, we get to it. And then there was the mayor's forum. That was at Baltimore City Community College. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if you heard this, Carlton, but you heard that Trone used a racial slur?
Yes, I just listened. It came in on my phone this morning. I meant to bring that up. In fact, I think it got into my phone. Yeah, where he used a slang word for black people.
Jigaboo. He called us jigaboos.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
He called us jigaboos. It's all right.
And he apologized.
They are rich white men
that
are calling black people jigaboos in 2024, and they want to represent black people in the state of Maryland, in the highest levels in the U.S. Senate. And so, Carlton, real quick, mm-hmm. there was Lasanti a few years ago. Mm-hmm. She's a delegate in Harper County, and she said this about Prince George's County. She said Prince George's County is a N-word district. So we have a lot, and Hogan asked her to resign or something. But, we have a lot of fights going on, and, we have to fight on many different fronts. And that's why I'm going, tomorrow someone mentioned, Marilyn Mosby. I'll close with this real quick. I'm going to the National Action Network conference. Not the conference, but to their regular meeting tomorrow. They meet every Saturday, so I'm going up there. And
you talking about the meeting in New York?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Yeah. Okay. I'm stepping the game up.
Okay, Hockey.
Making sure that Marilyn Mosby is front and center. Over the next couple of weeks. So that's what we need, real black leaders who've proven themselves and put in the work. And we need leaders to respect each other and keep organizing, keep working.
Thanks. Okay. All right.
To me, when people use racial slurs, it makes you question their circle of friends.
Friends, yeah.
Because at that the end too. Of the day, I mean, you see him in commercials and all his commercials. He has African-Americans. He has Hispanics. And it's like, okay, maybe he is familiar with our culture. Maybe he is familiar, you know, with our lifestyle, with who we are as people. But you know that that's probably not the first time he's used a word, right? And if he's still using a word, you know that when he uses it, he's probably not around any black people who would correct him privately. That's probably why he's saying it publicly and not thinking twice about it, because no one has corrected him about that being a racial slur, because when he uses it, no black people are around. Mm-hmm. His circle, his friends, his network. So that's the question that it brings up to me. Are you really understanding and down with the plight of African Americans in the state?
I'm coming to Rashid, Chuck, Ernest, excuse me, Nick, and William. Brother Rashid, you're on air.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. I want to congratulate all of our high school basketball teams that participated in the state championship last week.
Who won?
The first game, I did all of them. I'm the hype man. Carlton. I did all four games, right? So out of four games, we only lost one. You know, so we won three out of four. The first game was at 11 o'clock, and that was the Pikesville girls, and they won the first ever state championship.
Okay.
And the 1 o'clock game was your guys, Carlton. Your guys, you know, Emerson. And they won the back-to-back championships.
Okay.
And the 3 o'clock game was Carver, and they lost. But you got to understand, you know, Carver is not used to being there, because it was the first time in the school history to participate in the state championship.
Who'd they lose to? Who'd they lose to?
They lost to Largo, one of PG County schools.
All right.
And the last game was a 6 o'clock game, and the Power girls won by about 35 points.
Oh, okay.
You know?
All right.
I'd like to give a shout out to Kendall Peace, Abel. I've been playing basketball with her since elementary school. We went to Lincoln together and played, and she's been an incredible coach for Poly.
Oh, she's the coach at Poly?
She's a coach at Poly. Oh, she's been a coach for at least maybe the last 20 years, and she's also a graduate of Poly, so she's done a good job, you know, being a Baltimore citizen, getting educated, going back and helping her community, and not only basketball, but she's in the science math arena at the school teaching, so congratulations, Kendall.
Congratulations there. Chuck, you on air. Got a line open, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. Go ahead, Chuck.
Yeah, good morning, lady and gentlemen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I just wanted to clear up something about Trump in New York a little bit. You know, New York state law says that for a civil case, he has to do that bond before he do the appeal. Reason why? So he don't sell off all his assets and send all his money down to Cayman Islands. So when he lose the appeal, he'll still be able to pay the judgment. And that's the reason they do it.
Oh, okay.
Thanks for the info.
Thank you, Chuck.
Yeah. And it's real nice that nobody trusts him enough to lend him no money to make the bond, because they know he's a terrible businessman and they don't want to fool him.
Yeah, they know he don't pay.
That's right.
Yeah, okay.
His family won't even lend him their money. So you know what that tells you.
I'm going to say his son-in-law got $2 billion, okay, and ain't loaned him a dime.
Someone on the text line asks, would it be legal for a foreign nation to give Trump a loan?
Well,
since this is, quote unquote, business related, they're giving him a loan because of a civil business lawsuit.
You know, that question came up last week on a national level. It came up on Joe Scarborough's show and a couple other shows. The problem with that is, if you do that, who you owe to? That's going to be a real problem if that came about, in my opinion. That's not the first time that question has come up. It's come up in the last week about whether if Saudi Arabia or Putin or somebody would come up and loan him the money, then is that legal when he's running for president? Because if he became president, then who does he belong to? So that's a good question, but that question has come up.
And the answer is yes.
Yeah.
It's legal.
It's legal. It is legal. All right, we're coming to Ernest, Nick, William, Lee, and Tyrone. All right, Ernest, you're on air.
Yeah, good morning. Can I get Tehma's number? It was 410-667.
No, it's 667-334-7242.
What's the last part?
667-334-7242.
I don't know. Okay, thanks. But look, the reason I really called was, don't get upset with me, Carlton, but when you think about it, if you say you put, in relation to Brandon Scott, if you put a boy in to do a man's job, that don't sound too cool. I mean, if a white person said that, don't you think we might find that offensive?
That's why context matters. You got to take it into context.
I'm not saying it on a racial basis. I'm saying it on how I feel, that they put a boy in a man's job.
Okay, but the other thing, one more thing. Do you think that, why do everybody think we should help Haiti?
Go ahead, Bob.
You know, it's like they fighting against themselves. They killed the president last year, the president this year, Bush. And it's gangs and stuff. It's like it's Haiti people fighting against Haiti people.
Here's a reason why. Because we are responsible for the condition that Haiti is in. Haiti was the first country to declare its independence from colonization. In this case, it was France.
White French
people. And in order to, as a penalty for declaring their independence, they were required to pay reparations to France.
Yep.
A debt which, in order to pay that, the International Aid Agency rushed to their aid, provided some of the money, but basically paying off the debt to Haiti bankrupt the company, mm-hmm. bankrupt the country.
Yeah.
The president, the current president of Haiti, of course, and then the U.S. stepped in. The U.S. didn't step in to help the Haitians. The U.S. stepped in to help the French collect the money. And they also supported the current president, who refuses to step down. So, yes,
I told you what better than that, Bob. What? They went back and supported Papa Doc Duvalier, who was a dictator. Then they turned around when Papa Doc died, went and supported Baby Doc Duvalier until they put his butt out.
Yeah.
United States got a lot of in his hands on why Haiti's doing so bad, along with the French.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Bob. Finish.
That's the answer.
It's complicated, but thanks, because now I can go kind of research it and try to
figure
it out in my mind.
Because let me tell you something. They just got through paying the French their money back, I think, in 1996. That's how long they were paying.
For their own freedom.
For their own freedom. And that's a French-speaking nation.
Yes.
But it seemed like the people want the United States. Like I hear Al Sharpton.
Yeah, but we implicated in it. We supported those dictators down there that still... listen, when Baby Doc left, he left with $800 million when he went into exile. That was the country's money, not his.
Okay.
And so I guess his question is, why does it seem like the U.S. is solely responsible when it was already stated that France was involved in it as well? What responsibility do they have, or are they taking, or what are they contributing to Haiti? Because, I mean, still at the end of the day, the U.S. gives millions and millions of dollars to Haiti a year to one degree or another to help support their economy. Is France doing the same thing? Are the French doing the same thing?
Well, I don't know.
No, they're not.
And the problem is the millions of dollars that they gave didn't wind up in helping the people.
And
at
that's
all.
What it happens was, with 90% of the money that the U.S. give to foreign countries.
That is precisely yep. because, right. as I said, what the idea of controlling the people is to control the so-called leadership, not the individually.
Yep.
Let's go to William. You're on air, William.
Hey, how y'all doing? How you doing, Carl?
All right.
And Tehma and Robert. You know, my comment is about the show, Carlton. I've been listening to this show since it was inception, and it's a wonderful show, even though I don't agree with you all most of the time, except for Tehma. I think Tehma is a wonderful asset to the show. But what I want to say when I was listening to the first couple of callers about the, you know, like all three of y'all are very accomplished people, right? I have about 10 graduates in my family that's black. And all them are successful homeowners, college graduates, and everything. I just feel like sometimes the callers wake up with an attitude of the white people is out to get us, and I just don't agree because I'm 10 years younger than you. I'm 63, and I think that this country has changed a lot as far as black people go. I don't wake up every day thinking about white supremacy, right? Because I think that yes, when I was in elementary school, all my teachers were black. I didn't see a white teacher until I was in high school. But what I'm saying is, since the time I went to school, which was in the mid-60s up until 1980, so I think things have changed in this country, and it doesn't stop us from accomplishing things. That's all I'm saying. And as far as Trump goes, people wake up with Trump on their mind all the time. I mean, Trump hasn't been convicted of anything. He has not been convicted of anything, so he has a right to run for president. And I also think that us as black people, at least as far as I'm concerned, I celebrate God, right? I celebrate Jesus. I have faith. So I think that the United States is going to come out on top anyway. But, you know, we have to think positive, you know, not play victim all the time and worry about what white people think. You know, I just don't worry about what a white man thinks. And I don't think a white man can stop us from accomplishing what we need to accomplish because of the young people now that's under me.
Let me correct what may be a mission. When I said the country owes black people a debt, I didn't say white people owe black people a debt. See, you make the same mistake that white people make when they hear me say that, because and the reason is because they think they own the country. They actually think the country belongs to them. That's mm-hmm. what MAGA stands for. Mm-hmm. That's what really. So when the country pays off the debt, just like it would pay off a general obligation bond, those with money will have to contribute money to pay off that debt. And that includes some black people who have supposedly made it. Because the country owes the debt, and it's not on an individual basis. And everybody black who will not share the same in whatever form of reparations may ultimately come because everybody black didn't suffer to the same extent. It's not a one size fits all, but you can't resolve it on an individual basis. It is a country. It is a debt just like general obligation bonds are a debt, in my opinion.
Okay, William. Okay. Thank you, man. Appreciate you. Let's go to, we're coming, Lee. James Sherry. Oh, wait a minute, I'm sorry. Lee Tyrone. James and Sherry. And we got one line open because I'm getting ready to close it down in a moment. So if you want to get in real quick, 410-481-1010. Let's go to Lee. Lee, you're on air.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Mm-hmm. Last time I was on, y'all cut me off, right? But I'm going to go to the next thing, right? when you talk about the deal, when they talk about the people that raise the taxes and on everything, you know, the licenses and anything, you know, they do what they want to do any damn way. Excuse my language. But anyway, I'm talking about what about all these cameras around Baltimore City in the poor neighborhoods that you can't even get out nobody's way. Sometimes you got to get out people's way. You might have to speed up a little bit to get out somebody's way. You know how people drive in the city, man. And you end up getting, you can get a ticket anytime in the city. You know, you can be anywhere. It ain't like you're out of school all the time. It's just ridiculous. That's what I think anyway. So, you know, you can add that to the list that you was talking about.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Lee. Appreciate it.
All right.
Thanks. All right, we're going to Tyrone. Tyrone, you on air?
Yeah.
How's everybody doing?
Fine.
First of all, to thank y'all for that assessment of Haiti, the buzz I've heard on black radio outside of Carl Nelson. And then Thomas Jefferson himself said, as they freed themselves, Thomas Jefferson said this, I will crush Haiti economically, okay? So there's always been a vendetta against Haiti. As recently as Bill Clinton probably did it inadvertently, but Bill Clinton actually admitted to destroying the Haitian rice crop. The problem that people understand is that with regard to Haiti, which we occupied for 15 years at one time, they've always been concerned about the corporations, not the people there, just like all the banana republics in South, Central and South America. They're more concerned about the corporations that are making money off of the colonialism and all the other type of stuff that goes into exploiting their economy and their resources. So, but with that being said, that's not what I call for. I just wanted to make sure that people who are going to attend the rally tomorrow dress properly. It's going to be 56 degrees, but still dress in layers. I don't want anybody to be cold or anything.
And it's going to be raining like hell.
Yes. Wear a coat, and we're going to try to take care of that. Wear a coat and a hat, just like you was going into any building. Wear a coat and a hat when you leave that car. And as they say in the Army, it's better to have it and not need it than to need it and not have it. You can always take it off, but make sure you dress well tomorrow.
Okay.
And it's going to be at the YMCA, again, 1609 Jude Hill Avenue, Baltimore, Maryland, 21217. It is a show of unity. Yes, there was a black prosecutor. There always was a black. There's also a black judge. And this is the first trial she ever tried.
Okay. Thank you. Let's go to James, Sherry, and Diane. James, you on air.
Hey, how you guys doing? I'm going to make this real quick because I know you're going to close down. Since a lot of people don't know that this is all alleged, okay? About 50 years ago, the United States was thinking about dropping an atomic bomb on Haiti. Now, a lot of people don't know, when that president was assassinated over in Haiti, it was four other countries in Africa that was almost assassinated by French intelligence. But they don't talk about that. Now, the thing about them nations is that none of them accepted any of them vaccines or anything. Because I got a friend that I work with that is from Haiti. And he said that they really didn't have a lot of people getting sick, okay? So they didn't have no need for it.
James.
Okay?
James.
Yeah. It's all alleged, though.
Well, yeah. Okay. As long as it's alleged. Because I can't understand, first of all, what would be the reason to drop an atomic bomb on Haiti? I mean, they ain't got no weapons that can be dropped on us. So I don't even know. Who alleged this? Do you know?
I can get you the information.
Yeah, well, give me the information. Okay, give me the information next week, and we'll deal with it.
All right.
Thank you. Let's go to Sherry. Sherry, you on air.
Yes, hello, everybody, real quick. I heard two intelligent callers that called. One that just called, I think you say his name was Wade, the one that called about he have successful people in his family and people wake up with hatred. That's true. Mr. Douglas, you do always do white supremacists. So I would like to ask a question. Maybe we need to ask ourselves, why do so many black people hate white people? Maybe that's what we need to ask. And as far as teaching history, I have no problem with teaching history, letting your family know about history, but don't get so caught up in your history with white supremacists and everything where you can't move forward. We was taught history when we grew up, but you know what? You have to do that in a way where you can navigate through life. And as far as white people holding you down, I guarantee you, I don't think no black person or white person live in this world where they could do it just by their own color. So You never had white people that was instrumental in helping you in things?
No.
Mr. Douglas?
I haven't.
Oh, really?
No.
So you got to where you made it to be successful on your own just by the black culture. That's what you're telling me?
Yes, I am. And most black funeral directors in this country will tell you the same thing. Our business is built on being successful from black folk, not from white people. Just like white funeral directors are successful, but they want more money now because they don't look at the old days of segregation in the funeral industry. They looking at the green dollars.
So you never had to borrow from a bank. The only banks you mess with are black-owned banks?
You're right.
Telling me that?
You're right.
Oh, okay, Mr. Douglas.
And that could be a sign of the times, you know, based on what you grew up, your industry or professional, what have you. Me growing up in a different time, a different generation, that's not my story. I've had Jewish people help me out. I've had white people help me out. So things change over periods and times, and depending on what you're trying to do and your environment and who's in your circle of influence, that could be true.
And Tehma, you are exactly right. We're living in different times. So the thing about it is, I don't like it when people say we have to get black leaders in. No, get the person that's right that could do that job. I don't need to know if you white, Tehma. I don't care what your skin color is. Can you do the job? Well, you might not be white. You might be black. But the thing that we shouldn't get caught up on labels. Have a good weekend, people, and have a good day. And Mr. Dashiell, stop being so hateful, man. You say we got to know our history and we made that man was right. You did come out and say that. This is our country and we ain't never going to forget it. The black people did this. Have a good day, Jesse.
Well, you ain't saying that and getting off the phone, Daddy. You got a habit of always making some kind of allegation or accusation and then talk about have a nice day and then we'll hang up. No, you can make an answer.
You're getting ready to get an answer
from Bob Dashiell. Go ahead, Bob.
Give me an answer, Michelle.
I believe that you're going to believe what you want to believe, and so I'm not going to waste my time trying to convince you of anything.
Because
you didn't repeat what I said anyway. You hear it the way you want to hear it, and you're going to believe what you're going to believe. And I just don't have enough time left to try to convince you otherwise. So I prefer not to.
Let me finish. People are needed from everywhere. People are needed.
You did not hear me say that all black people hate white people. You did not hear me say that white people, that there are no individual white people that have ever helped individual black people. If you listened to me, you heard me say the opposite of all of that.
I was in the car. I said that. But let me say, and I'm leaving.
Okay.
You know what? I know that there are certain groups that need it to keep black people on the plantation like this, to spew these things, because every election year they come up with the same thing, reparation, and black people ain't got it in centuries, but for some reason, black people walk that line. They can't tell you why they don't like Trump, but they can't tell you what Biden has done.
They don't like it because he's the head of the plantation. Now, let's go to Diane. Last caller for today. Oh, come on here. Talk about the plantation. Trump is the plantation leader. Diane, you on there?
Good afternoon. Good morning. How y'all doing?
Good morning. How are you?
Y'all just made me laugh. I want to ask you a question. I want to make sure that I heard you correctly.
Okay.
Concerning reparations. And I want to say this. All Jewish people get a check from the United States, but the Holocaust did not happen in the United States. Didn't it happen in Germany? Nazi Germany?
There is also a Holocaust Reparation Commission in Germany, which still pays out.
Pays the
so they get a check from here in the United States and Germany
and Holocaust payments are non-taxable in the state of Maryland.
But wait a minute.
But go ahead. What's your question?
Well, no, I got a question.
My question is, do the payments come from the United States?
Yeah, what payments you talking about come from the United States to all Jews? I ain't never heard that before.
I've been around them, and I go to a lot of their meetings and stuff. And I was told that they do get a check from the United States.
You saying all Jews?
All Jews.
We're going to have to check that out.
I'm not
aware. I've never heard that.
I'm not aware of that.
I've never heard that.
I have.
All right.
Okay.
Well, we got to go. But get us more information on that, Diane. Got to go because we're up against the clock. But you got to get us more information on that. And I'll research it here, Tehma. If you find out anything about it, let us know, please. Go ahead. Get ready to close out.
Thank you for listening today. I'm Tehma Smith-Wilson. If you need to contact me off air, I can be reached at 667-334-7242. And as always, do not forget to tune in on Mondays at 1 o'clock here on 10:10 a.m. for Coach's Game Time Conversation. If you won the tickets today, I'll be contacting you and putting them in the mail for you. Have a great weekend.
Somebody did get my five that I gave. Oh, all right.
Congratulations to all the winners.
Bob.
Have a great week in Baltimore. This is Robert Dashiell again. My number is 410-547-8820. If you really need to talk to me, you can reach me by text at 410-456-8606.
Thanks to our engineer, Fats. Appreciate you. And as I said, the viewing for Calvin Brown will be today from 3 to 7 at Maranatha Truth Center, 701 East 25th Street, with services tomorrow. The wake at 10, the funeral at 11 at the same center. Every week from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB is the Frank M. Conaway Sr. NL Show with co-host Attorney Tehma Smith-Wilson, Attorney Robert Bob Shields, yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. And as I always say, take your head with your ear, put it to the ground. Listen to the grass grow. See ya. Don't want to be ya. Bye. And you best believe she hardly gets a penny. Living just enough for the city.
Talk in the day. Soul at night on the new 1010 WOLB.